Duane, good evening. Good evening. Good to see you again. Picture in your mind, if you would, a year ago where this room was filled with 95 people. 95. We, for the last 3 years now, we've had, remember, Jeremy, it was like between 95 and 105 would come on a given night. The tables were all the way up to here, real close together and everything, and it's just a different look and feel. So I want to commend you in a special way for coming out tonight and, you know, being with us in person. And I know that on the media here that we'll have some people zooming in. I think last week we had three. The week before that we had seven. So I just think it's great that we're together that way. So I want to commend you for driving and being with us. How many went to vote today? How many went to vote? Great. How'd y'all, how long do you have to stand in line? I stood in 1 hour and a half. How about, is anybody probably longer than that? Jeremy, long? Yeah, it was worth it. I mean, there's countries around the world that give their right arm to be able to vote. I mean, you know, they're told what to do, and it's they're bred inbred into who's the leader and all that. So we are blessed to be in a country where we can put our 2 cents in there and vote. So we'll know soon. So thank you for being here, and we're ready to go. We have session number 8. Can you believe it? We're going to go through. Let's look at a few things here, if you would, please, Brandon. And with just a little review, we have some new people, and it's just a little review. Just to let you know, we're talking about the Mass. Four different sessions. We had session 1 last week. We're going to have session 2, 3, and 4. And it's on the Mass. It's how we in the Catholic Church give praise and worship to God. It's the greatest prayer in the world, we believe. We're going to share that with you. And so here's how, whereas Mass is offered, the attendance at Mass here at Holy Spirit, we begin on the evening of Saturday, 5 o'clock. And then we have 2 morning Masses. And then we have an afternoon Mass. And typically it's presided with a priest that can speak it in Spanish, and it's usually full. We're now bringing in chairs. You know, our church seats 1,000. We have it roped off, and so you're talking 450. And there are so many of the Hispanic community coming in chairs. This week we had them also sit in the chapel that seats 80, and we have the speakers in there, but they can't see. And next week we think they're going to be in here. So we can zoom it in, and they can watch the liturgy from here and hear it, and then go into the church for Holy Communion. So, but those are the offerings for us. It's 1 p.m. at St. Francis of Assisi, 3 miles away. They also have a Saturday evening Mass. There's a 6, and then the 2 morning Masses and 2 afternoon Masses. The 7 p.m. really works into the schedule there for the UA students who might want to do things on Sunday, but then at the end of the day, Sunday, come and give time for God. So during the week, we meet every morning at 6:45 here. Okay, thank you. So, Brandon, next one, please. So here's our schedule. And by the end of the first column, then, that'll be right before our break at Thanksgiving. So we're at November 3rd, and it's the Liturgy of the Eucharist, and that's what we're going to talk about tonight. And then we have 2 more. So stay tuned, and y'all have a schedule. That's what's before you as far as if you are continue to be curious about what we're going to break open. Okay, the next one, please, Brandon. And any questions, of course, raise your hand or write them down. There was nothing in the box last week, so but put in the box on your way out, and we'll answer it the following week. Okay? And here again, no one's asked for the recordings yet, but we are going to record this in just a minute. We'll turn it on, and then you can get a copy if you want to hear it again or share it with someone. And, of course, it's going to be stored on the YouTube. Okay. And for those of you that are viewing virtually, thank you for being with us from afar. If you would call the office, there's our phone number, and then just let Lori know so that we can keep you posted if we send out emails or we send out information on classes that change or instructions like that. Any questions, you can send them into, okay? And our textbooks, you know, the Bible, and we're going to continue to refer to that, you know, especially as we get into where is the Mass in the Bible. That's the next 2 classes after this. And you want to bring your own Bible to highlight if you don't have one. We have one to offer to you to purchase. Okay, and the next one here would be the Catechism. We're going to refer to that in a big way tonight. This is like the definitive book when you talk about the Eucharist. What is the Eucharist? Well, it's got a glossary, and then you look it up in the index, and you can go, and we're going to look at some definitions. It's a great book to help you understand the mystery that we talk about in the Catholic Church. So it's like $8 or $10 or something, but they're available tonight too. Okay. And let's see. I think before we enter into the prayer, any questions so far? Any questions before the test? Okay. You're awake now. Okay. I'll go ahead and start the recorder, and then we'll go ahead and have a prayer, an opening prayer, and then we'll begin our presentation for this evening. came. If you choose, you can bless yourself with the sign of the cross, and let's begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, we gather together to continue our never-ending quest to come to know you and love you more fully. You are the source of infinite knowledge, and we are your attentive students. Open our eyes, our ears, our minds, and our hearts to let your Holy Spirit come in. Fill us with the wisdom to see and appreciate the mystery of the Mass, that it is more than just a prayer of praise, that it is the most worthy form of worship that we can offer to you. Help us to experience the Mass as thanksgiving and memorial and sacrifice and meal, the most holy of all the encounters that we will ever have with you this side of heaven. We ask all of this in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you. I'd like to point out to you a handout. We gave you a handout that's a two-sided handout for this class. And so for those of you viewing from afar, you can get on our website and print it out for yourselves. It's just an overview. You don't have to refer to it in detail right now. But in the back of the Bible that we offer, there are four pages there that really summarize what we're doing. So on where it says, with the title here, it says Celebration of the Eucharist, okay? So there's four departments here, or compartments here, if you want to look at it that way, okay? So if you had these four, that's what's on this chart here. So don't let it be too confusing where you are troubled by it, okay? We have introductory rites, okay? We went into that last week, so you have like four paragraphs there, or five, of introductory rites. And then there's the liturgy of the word, and that covers the front side of the page. What did we talk about? We talked about the readings from Scripture. We talked about the psalm, the gospel, and the homily, and then the profession of faith. And so you have your introductory rites. As we begin Mass, it takes about 5 minutes. Then we enter into the liturgy of the word, and that's the remaining, you would say, the first half hour. Typically, part one would be about 1/2 hour of prayer. And then part two would typically be another 1/2 hour of prayer, okay, on a Sunday. On a weekday, this would be abbreviated so that this would be 1/4 of an hour, 1/4, and then 1/4. It's just, there's less singing, there's less people to serve for communion, and there are fewer readings. So that we can honor the fact that people are trying to pray, but then go on their way with their day. It's not as elaborate and majestic as it is on the weekend. And then here, the Liturgy of the Eucharist is where we are now. So if you turn on the back, there's like three different bold areas there that talk about the Eucharist. One is preparation, right, where we prepare the altar with the gifts, prepare for the sacrifice, and then we prepare the Eucharistic prayer, which is the great prayer we pray to the Father through the Son. And then we have the communion rite, where the miraculous transubstantiation of the elements of bread and wine become him. And then we distribute Holy Communion to the people. And then we have the concluding rite. So I just think this is important just to see so it's not so confusing. Okay, so there's four parts that we want to divide the Mass into for your understanding. Okay, Brandon, can we look at the first slide? I think we do a little more of a review here, if we could. Last week we talked about liturgy. We call this a liturgy, okay? There's the word several times, liturgy of the word, liturgy of the Eucharist. And this is where the word comes from. It means a gathering of God's people, okay? It's a holy gathering, it's an assembly, and it's the work of the people. We do it together, okay? So when we say liturgy, that's what it refers to. It doesn't have to be the Mass. We could have the liturgy of adoration on Friday night over there, so it's a little different liturgy, but it is a gathering, an assembly, and a work of the people, okay? And let's look at the next one, please. And then the Mass. You know, where did that word come from, and what does that word mean? I think we have definitions here, just to review. So it comes from Latin words, mission or sending. That's what it means as far as a noun, mission. And then it also has a verb. So the next one is, it's announced at the end of every Mass, and it means to send, mitre, to send. We're going to send you on your way, hopefully renewed and fed in the love of God, so that we can go out and be witnesses of him in the world. Okay, so we're on a mission, and we're going to go. So when I say the Mass is ended, go in peace. When the priest said that in Latin, he would use other words, and that's how we got the name. So So that's a little graphic. I don't think we filled it in on the, I think Ryan had a way of, oh, there you go. I didn't know how to do that. Okay, good deal. So there's the introductory rites. I tried to print it up here, and then the liturgy of the word, and you guys are great. So again, it's very simple, okay? So we're in the second part of the celebration of the Mass, and we're going to go through those through the missalette that we have, and you should have one now. If not, we'll get one over to you. Okay, so in the liturgy of the word, you know, we finished last week. What did we do? Okay, there's a little summary of what we did, okay? And well, I don't know if it goes bullet by bullet, but there's like 5 points. The first thing we do when we gather together is we tell God we're sorry, okay? We are not perfect, and we are not saints. And so to begin every Mass and say, look, I'm going to look inward, and I'm sorry for the things I said, the things that I looked at, the things that I did, all the hurts and everything, please have mercy on me, okay? And so we do that at the beginning of every Mass. And there's little prayers that help us to do that, okay? So we expressed our sorrow, and then we praise God. On Sunday, we go right into the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to his people of goodwill. So that's another thing we do. We do it in prayer, and we do it in song. And then we listen, okay? And then everybody's seated. They've been standing for the entrance, and now we're seated, and now we can sit down. And so there are 4 readings from God's book, the Bible. So we have an Old Testament reading, typically, and then we have a psalm that is sung, and we respond. That's a responsorial song. And then there's the second reading from the New Testament, and then there's a gospel, one of the 4, Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. And so we listen to God, the word proclaimed, and then the minister, a priest or deacon, will break that open with regard to how that applies to you in this day and time and on that occasion. And so it's called preaching, okay? And so it's all about trying to make it applicable to your life so that it means something, and then you can carry it forward. And then number 4, we declared our belief in God, and that's called the creed. Credo is the Latin word, means I believe, and there's a form for that. And the church in her wisdom has put together, what are the main articles of our faith, okay? And so we declare that together. I believe in one God. I believe in Jesus the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. I believe in his church. So by the time you say that, you've really reminded yourself of the truths that we believe. And then one more, I think, we have number 5. And then we thank God, you know. The very word, folks, of Eucharist, it comes from Eucharistia, and it means thanksgiving, okay? So we are so thankful to God for everything, for life and the promise of eternal life. And so we thank God for blessings, and we beg him for more. You know, in the middle of the Mass, we have the prayer of the faithful. We lift up our petitions to the Father. We pray for the sick. We pray for the dying. You know, we pray for our country. We pray for our president. So we're constantly beseeching God for help, and that's a good thing. He said, ask, and you shall receive. And so if we're humble enough to ask God for what we need, he delights, like a good parent, he delights in helping the children receive the help that they ask for. So that's a review of the first part of the Mass there, where we have done all of that in like a half hour, okay? And so now we're going to migrate into another area. Well, first, a couple of definitions. You're going to hear the word Paschal mystery, okay? What is the Paschal mystery, if someone asks you? You know, it's a big word, Paschal, the Pasch. What is that? Well, it really comes to view when we celebrate Easter and we celebrate the Triduum, the 3 high holy days, and we're celebrating, you know, the times that he came forward and he suffered so horribly and then he died. Okay, that's the Passover. So it includes the suffering of Jesus. There was suffering through the 3 years of his ministry, of course, but then it kind of got to a pinnacle there where it was horrible suffering, okay, the Paschal mystery. And then the death, you know, they nailed him to the cross. And I used to think that the dying of Christ on the cross was the crucifixion. The crucifixion is when you pierce the flesh with the nails, with the spikes, you know, he's crucified. And then they let him hang there for 3 hours. We believe that they nailed him at noon and he died at 3. See, he didn't die. When they crucified people, they didn't die from blood loss. They don't go through here either. This tissue is so soft that they would fall down. It would just tear and they would fall down. They usually do it here between these 2 bones and this bone. So they would crucify the person here, and then they would crucify and put the spike through their feet, either 1 foot on top of the other or individually. And so there they are on the cross. They're still breathing. They're not bleeding too bad. But and they're trying to support their weight on their feet, okay? And they get more and more tired. And pretty soon, you know, you have to push up just to take a breath. And when you're pushing up on the spike you're pushing up, your feet are nailed to the wood, and you're pushing up on that and pulling yourself up to breathe, okay? So can you imagine doing that? And so they die by suffocation. Their lungs fill up with water and they can no longer breathe, and so typically they would die from suffocation. And that's why in Scripture, you know, after they had hung on the cross for so long, and they said, go over and break their legs. And I often wonder, why are you going to break their legs, okay? Well, if you break your legs, you can no longer support yourself, and you can no longer breathe, okay? And so it's horrible. I mean, that's the death of Jesus that he suffered, and they did that to many, many good people. And after him, they continued to crucify Christians. That was their standard form of execution. So the resurrection of Jesus, now, you know, he died, and then he rose from the dead after 3 days, as he predicted. You know, the whole thing through Isaiah, Old Testament, the prophets, and Jesus himself several times said that I will rise on the third day. And he did. He rose from the dead, never to die again. After 40 days, he then ascended to the Father, and then he sent his first gift, and that was the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. And so the sending of the Holy Spirit on the 50th day is called Pente, means 50, and that was, it was already a Jewish holiday. Pentecost was already celebrated as a Jewish holiday. But here again, the Pentecost from the Christian era meant that it was the 50th day after he rose, and that he sent his Holy Spirit, God's Holy Spirit, into the world, visible as tongues of fire on the top heads of the apostles. And truly, they were inflamed with the love of God to go out, boldly to go out. They just saw what they did to him, but they didn't care that they went out to all the different surrounding areas and spread the good news. Christ is risen. Christ is risen as he said he would rise, never to die. We got to follow him. So that's the Paschal mystery. You know, we talk about praise and worship, the words praise and worship. Sometimes we talk about them as if they're interchangeable. You know, from school we had synonyms, you know, it means the same thing. One word means the same as the other. I'll never forget, I was interviewing a woman in my office at my last parish up there at St. Elizabeth Ann Seton, and she and her husband were getting married, so we're just getting them prepared. She was not Catholic. And so she said, I'm the praise and worship minister at the Gardendale First Baptist Church. I said, you are? I said, great. I said, what's the difference between praise and worship? And she just looked at me. I thought she didn't hear me. I said, you're the praise and worship minister. What is the difference between praise and worship? And she didn't answer. So I just went on to something else. Is there a difference? Do they mean the same thing? You know, they're so often used as if they're interchangeable. Why would you have two words in the same sentence? I'm the praise and worship minister, if they're two different things, okay? So let's take a look. I mean, I think worship involves sacrifice. That's different than just praise. I mean, we could just sing a song right now, holy, 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 and we praise God with our words and with our instruments, and we can praise him by our thoughts and our prayers. But here again, worship involves sacrifice. It always has. In the Old Testament, you know, from the very beginning, they were told to kill an ox or a bullock or a lamb or a ram or a goat, and then to let the blood flow, and then to offer it and burn the carcass in a holocaust, okay? And they did that. They got to do that every day. So the Jews in the temple, when the temple was built, at 10 in the morning and 2 in the afternoon, they would slaughter an animal and they would offer that. It was done by the priests. They would slaughter that on an altar and they would offer that animal to God. That's what God asked them to do. And they did it in a beautiful way. Okay? And that was to prefigure what he would do. We would say that the wood of the cross is the altar on which Jesus was crucified. And so he offered himself. He is priest and victim. So I think we have a few other things on here. Oh, wait, we'll get to that. But in order to have worship, you have to have an altar, a priest to offer a sacrifice, and then you have to have a victim. What are you offering? And they were offering animals before. And so Jesus came to be called the Lamb of God. So it's like God the Father has his son under his arm, and he's going to allow him to be offered in sacrifice on the altar of the cross, as the once-for-all sacrifice, where God is now the Lamb, the victim, and God is also the priest. Hebrews calls Jesus many times, he is the eternal high priest. Who did he offer? He offered himself on the cross in reparation for our sins. It was the only sacrifice that could ever atone for the sin of mankind, for all mankind. So he offered himself. So worship involves sacrifice, and every time we pray the Mass, what we're doing is we're participating again and again into this great eternal sacrifice. Eternal means that it doesn't end, okay? And so you can't repeat something that never ends. And what we're doing in the Mass is we're investing ourselves to enter into the once-for-all sacrifice again and again by God's design. So who are we offering to the Father? His Son, truly present on the altar, and we offer him to the Father just as he offered himself to the Father 2,000 years ago. So there is a difference between praise and worship. That's why there's a priesthood. That's why in the Catholic Church we have altars. And that's why we bring forward the elements that we're going to talk about here. I think the next one is the elements, unleavened bread and wine. That's what our Lord used at the Last Supper. That's what they did. We have the Seder, S-E-D-E-R, the Seder meal here without COVID. We have it here to celebrate right around the Easter time. We didn't do it this year because of the situation. But that's the high holy day of the Jewish celebration, of the Jewish Passover, is the Seder Supper. And so what our Lord did, they had all the bitter herbs, and they had all of the unleavened bread, and they had the 4 cups of wine. There's prayers that go with each of those. We pray all those prayers, okay? So this is the wine. So the elements of offering are these two. And then what Jesus did, he took the Jewish Passover meal, the Seder Supper, and he platformed it. He transformed it into the Mass, okay? He took the bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to him and said what? Take and eat, this is my body. Well, they'd never heard that before. And then he took the cup filled with wine and he blessed it and gave it to him and said, take and drink, this is my blood. Well, they'd never heard that before. They just drank them as, you know, part of the ceremony. And so it's like, wow. And so then he said, do this in memory of me. Do what, Lord? Do what? Do this. Do what I just did. Celebrate the Passover meal by allowing me to change the elements of bread and wine into me. And then take and eat. This is me, my body and blood. Take and drink. This is me, the body and blood. They're both together. We're going to get into the mystery of that. But there you go. And so there are elements of the sacrifice that are part of the Mass, that are an intrinsical part of the Mass, and they're brought forward in ceremony without COVID. We have the handoff, and we take, and we then bring them to the altar. Otherwise, with COVID, we just go ahead and leave them on the altar to begin with, so no one has to touch them but the ministers. Okay. There are the three dimensions of a sacrifice. There's got to be an altar, and a priest, and a victim. Okay. Let me think. We're probably getting into the missal there just a little bit. So let me just see. I'd like to read a passage from a scripture to connect where we are so far. And so if you have your Bibles, let's open to John for a minute, and the Gospel of John. And we'll look at chapter 4. You may remember that there was a Samaritan woman, and all the apostles went to get something to eat, you know, and Jesus is alone by the well, and the Samaritan woman is there, and she's trying to draw water, and it's so unusual that Jesus, a Jew, would strike up a conversation with a Samaritan woman. So you may know this passage. I'm just going to go over some highlights to point out what he said to her at the end of their conversation. You know, he says, woman, give me a drink. His disciples had gone. This is chapter 4, verses, let's start at 7 or 8, okay? Jews had nothing in common with Samaritans, okay? And the woman said to him, how can you, a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink? Jesus answered her and said, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked me for a drink, and I would have given you living water. Wow. She had no idea. So she changes her tone right away. She said, sir, you do not even have a bucket, and this cistern is deep, okay? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave this cistern and drank from it and filled his flocks? So he goes on, okay? And Jesus said to her, go call your husband and come back. And the woman answered and said to him, I do not have a husband. Jesus answered and said, you are right in saying, I do not have a husband, for you have had 5 husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true. The woman said to him, sir, I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped, here's the word, it shows up several times in this brief passage, our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you people say that the place to worship is in Jerusalem. Jesus said to her, believe me, woman, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You people worship what you do not understand. We worship what we understand, because salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. And indeed, the Father seeks such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. Then it goes on from there. She goes and grabs her friends, and they really start to believe in the Lord. But I thought that was a powerful passage in John where he kind of explains to her, we're not going to worship on this mountain or the mountain we're on today. We're going to worship, and he knew what would happen, where we would worship in spirit and in truth. And that's what we do in celebration of the Mass. When we have the Holy Spirit, we call down the Holy Spirit. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, the elements of bread and wine are transubstantiated into the body and blood of Jesus in spirit and in truth. Jesus is the truth. Remember, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And so what we do is we then offer him at the end of the Eucharistic prayer to the Father, and we just ask for his blessing. Through him, with him, in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. And gives the Father great glory that we praise him and offer the sacrifice of his Son to him again and again and again. So that's on a high level. And we're going to dig deep into this next week and the week after that on where all these pieces are in the Bible. But I just want to point out that truly when we say, are we going to worship the Lord? We're worshiping the way our Lord said, okay? The hour is coming and is now here where true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. And indeed, the Father seeks such people to worship him. Okay. Please, Brandon, what's our next one, please? Oh, comparatives and superlatives. Okay. I think we're maybe just a step ahead of ourselves there. Okay. We'll get back to that. Okay. What I'd like to do now is on the catechism, I want to give you some definitions. And so if you have the catechism, you can open it. And otherwise, we're going to go into the great word Eucharist, okay? And we'll hold off on that. We're going to spend a moment on this. It may be a word that you never heard before, okay? And if you had your catechism, you'd go to the very back, and you would see like three pages of sub-definitions or sub-passages here that relate to Eucharist in your little catechism. But if you have yours with you, you'd be on page 775. Okay, on 775, it says Eucharist as sacrament, Eucharist, what is it called? Eucharist, Christ's presence, Eucharist eschatological, that's the end times, importance, institution, made effects, just so many things. I'm going to go right to, for brevity, I'm going to go right to a certain page, and it's page number 368. Page number 368, and I think if you would, Brandon, if you would please come down a couple of slides, and we'll go with 1322 is the passage. So we might come back to comparatives, and okay, here's There's the passage from John, folks, if you want to write down that passage. It's John, I think, chapter 4, and it starts around, 1322, please, if you would, 1322. Probably go back. There you go. Go back. I don't know how we missed it. Go one more. Okay, let's just hold that there. Okay. 1324 will be fine. Okay. So in your book, if you were to look at the sacrament of the Eucharist, this is profound, the explanations of what this really is, okay? The Eucharist is the source and the summit of the Christian life. The other sacraments, and indeed all other ministries and works, are bound up with the Eucharist and are oriented toward it, okay? For in the Blessed Eucharist is contained the whole spiritual good of the Church, namely Christ himself, okay? What we would say as Catholics that we identify seven sacraments. That's channels of grace that are available, like baptism. Baptism is the gate sacrament that when the Holy Spirit comes in at baptism, that opens us up to receiving all the other sacraments. And so that's a channel of grace, okay? And so you receive power in baptism. You receive power in confirmation. You receive healing in confession. But you receive the power and the presence of Jesus in Holy Communion, okay? So that's what it says. They're bound up with the Eucharist, Jesus, and are oriented toward it. For in the Blessed Eucharist is contained the whole spiritual good of the Church, namely Jesus, himself, our Pasch, okay, the Paschal mystery. So I like to think of it as a diamond, you know. It's like if you had the glistening gem, you know. And so the Eucharist is the source and the summit of our Catholic faith. Paul would say he is all in all. He's the beginning and he's the end. He's the first and the last. And to have him available to us this side of heaven is so huge. Remember he said several times, I will never leave you. I will not leave you orphans. Well, how are you exactly going to do that, Lord? It's not just spiritually. It's truly, truly he would never leave us. He said that. And so he hasn't. Through the great miracle he did at the Last Supper, and he said, do this, then every day and in every way, he is with us, what we call sacramentally. He is veiled under the appearance of bread, and he's truly there. And we see him through the eyes of faith. We can't see him because he can taste different. We can't see him because it looks different. It's sort of like he said it. He said, take and eat, this is my body. Take and drink, this is my blood. Do this in memory of me. And they went right out and did it. That's what Paul and the apostles, they went right out and started to pray the Mass so that they would have the Lord with them in a substantial way, in a sacramental way, over and over again. Okay. So that's one definition, folks, I want to share with you, and then we'll look at just a few more here. Please, please, go ahead, Rachel.
I was wondering why young children can take part in the Eucharist. They've already been baptized or taken. Why not?
You know, in some traditions, the children, as infants, they receive all three sacraments at birth. And so they can receive baptism, confirmation, and Holy Eucharist right away. I mean, they're so innocent. I mean, of anyone that could receive the Lord who is all pure, it would be a child, okay? And there are some rites of the church, R-I-T-E-S, some rites of the church. We're the Latin rite, and right now we have the ability to do it that way, but right now we're doing it such that we space it out so that it makes a little bit, when the children reach the age of reason, say 7 years old, second grade, then we offer to them then the Holy Communion. And then when they are a little further along, let's say eighth grade, okay, then we offer them the sacrament of confirmation. Our new bishop has mentioned to me that he's thinking of bringing it all the way back in our diocese now to the beginning. So you're absolutely right. I mean, with baptism, there is no sin. And there's no sin till they get to the age of reason and then they choose to disobey mom or say something bad or something. But we want them to be prepared to then, okay, now how do you go back to Jesus and repent? You've sinned. You've offended mom. You've offended him. And so we go through holy confession, how to do that, okay? So you can tell God you're sorry, hopefully every day, and like that. Does that help?
Yeah.
Okay. For those of you that are live streaming, the question was, why can't children receive communion? And they can. They absolutely can, okay? And you want some level of awareness that it's not candy, that this is very special. So kind of we wait a little bit. I mean, it's not magic. It's not. It's mystery. And so that's why we wait a little bit, or that's why our tradition has waited a little bit, so that they really can appropriate what it is they've just received, okay? All righty, thank you. Okay, now the next one would be, what's our next one? Okay. The inexhaustible richness of this sacrament is expressed in different names that we give it. Each name evokes a different aspect of it. It is called Eucharist because it is an action of thanksgiving. Remember I said the word Eucharist means thanksgiving, thanksgiving to God. The Greek word Eucharistine and eulogine recall the Jewish blessings that proclaim, especially during a meal, excuse me, God's works, creation, redemption, and sanctification. Okay, so some of the names, and I think we go, please, the next one there, Brandon. No, that's it. I'm going to, 1328, and I'll give you some of the names that we refer to the Eucharist. So 1328 is one. The Lord's Supper, you know, we get together, we could say that it's the Lord's Supper, and indeed it is. It's a representation of the Lord's Supper, the Last Supper. It's also the breaking of the bread. That's what you find in the Acts of the Apostles, when they went out now and started to do what God asked them to do, is to have Eucharist. Paul would refer to it many times as there they were, and they saw him in the breaking of the bread. It's another way that we could refer to our celebration on Sunday. We call it the Eucharistic Assembly, okay? We're gathering to give thanksgiving to God. We call it the Memorial. In every Mass, we're remembering this. We start here. People don't want to look at that. They don't even want to think about that. But yeah, you know, as often, Paul would say, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes again. We can never forget the cost of our salvation, we can never forget the immense love that God has for us, that he died for us so that we could live. It's called the Holy Sacrifice. When we talk, these are other ways to refer to the Mass or to the Eucharist, the Holy and Divine Liturgy. We call it the Most Blessed Sacrament. As I was mentioning before, we're going to go deeper in future classes. If there are seven sacraments, it's all the power of God. But the Eucharist is premier. It is the power and the presence of God. So if they're all blessed, we would say this is the most blessed sacrament, okay? And we have a shrine that's on the interstate up there on the way up in Hansville. It's called the Shrine of the Most Blessed Sacrament. Remember that? It's on. You see it when you go up there to Kimberly, you know? It's like, wow. So they put that on the sign. This is the Shrine of the Most Blessed Sacrament because it's the Shrine of the Eucharist, okay? So when you hear that designation here, that would make sense. And it's referred to as Holy Communion. That's the meal part of the celebration, okay? Holy Mass, Holy Meal, Liturgy, and then the sending forth. So just a few ideas there that you will hear what we're talking about here under a couple of different names, okay? Please there, Brandon, the next one. The Lord, having loved those who were his own, he loved them to the end. And knowing that the hour had come to leave this world and return to the Father, in the course of the meal, the Last Supper, he washed their feet and gave them the commandment of love, in order to leave them a pledge of his love, in order never to depart from his own and make them sharers in his Passover. He instituted the Eucharist as the memorial of his death and resurrection, and he commanded his apostles to celebrate it until his return. He thereby constituted them priests of the New Testament. So those apostles, they were the first priests of the church. Okay, Peter and John and all of them, they were the first priests, and they had the power to confect, I say confect the sacrament, to make it happen. You know, you could come to the altar in the church over there, and you could hold the bread in your hand, and you could read the same words that I read, and nothing happens. Why? Because you don't have the power, okay? It's not my power. It's the power of God that's bestowed on me in another sacrament called Holy Orders, okay? So when the bishop puts his hands on a man's head and he prays for the Holy Spirit to give him the power to stand in the place of Christ at the altar and in the confessional, then the power is there to confect the sacrament. Does that make sense, you guys? Does it? I mean, like I say, you could stand there and read the words and hold the elements and that nothing happens to the elements. Sacramentally, nothing happens mysteriously because you don't have the power. And so he constituted them priests of the New Testament, and they were not only priests but bishops. The apostles were the first bishops, which means they had the power to lay their hands on other men and consecrate them to be priests. And you see that in 1 Timothy and Titus, that Paul is writing those letters to those men that he consecrated. They were his priests, okay? Okay, please, if you would, Brandon. Okay, is that it at the end of there? Good, thank you. Okay. You know, we're saying some words, folks, and just I want to go and explain three words that you'll hear us say, and we kind of assume people know what they are. And one is transubstantiation. I'm going to write it up here. It's a big word. We had a little Bible study or a Bible school one summer, and it was starting from fifth grade all the way up. And I asked anybody in the community there of these kids. They had like 30 kids. I said, "Does anybody know the name of the miracle that takes place, you know, at Mass that changes the bread and the wine into the body and blood of Jesus?" And this little fifth grader says, "It's transubstantiation." No, 5 years old, not a fifth grader, 5 year old, this little kid. I said, "Really?" She said, "Oh, yes, transubstantiation. You want me to spell it?" And then before I could say yes or no, she spelled it. I said, "Wow, that's some good home training, let me tell you." The little kid, I was so impressed, okay? What does this mean, okay? Trans means across. And this is the word substance, okay? So, across the whole substance of the elements that are on the altar there, of the, all the little hosts that are baked and they're there, across the whole of the substance that is now changed, that is now changed, that is now the true and substantial presence of Jesus Christ. It's changed. See, there's a substance. We would say that the accidents remain the same from a philosophical standpoint, that the word accidents, which means the appearance of it. It looks like bread, tastes like bread, smells like bread, you know, feels like bread. So the accidents remain the same, but by the great miracle, across the whole substance, it's now the true and substantial presence of Jesus. Okay. So when you hear us talk about transubstantiation, that's what we're talking about. Another word. There's just three that I wanted to share with you at this time, just to give you an overview, okay? Would be consecration, okay? So it was customary for people to look at the consecration, which is where I hold up the elements, okay? I just said the prayer, and then I hold them up, and I hold them up for your adoration, okay? You may be looking down, praying, or whatever, and then when you see me hold up the host, or when you see me hold up the chalice that has the blood in it now, you would just say, my Lord and my God, or whatever you'd like. It's just a time to just adore, okay? And so that's the moment of consecration. Consecration means to set aside, okay? To set aside for something holy. And when we consecrate a church, we go and we put holy oil on each of the four walls, north, south, east, and west, and we set aside that church just for spiritual meetings. We don't have parish council in there. We don't have finance council. The church is just for religious things, okay? And so this bread and wine now has been set aside as the body and blood of Jesus, which is our nourishment and our Lord, okay? So you hear the consecration at that point in the Mass. And then the last one would be true presence. We refer to the Eucharist as the true presence of our Lord. And so we go to great lengths in church just to witness to that. You know, I genuflect before the tabernacle, you know, when we are done, you know, just like if you had your cereal box and you put the cereal, what's in the bag? Crumbs, right? If you put the cereal in your bowl, you know, there's always crumbs, whether it's hot chocolate or whether it's cereal. And so if Jesus is in the host, he's in every element of the host. He's in every particle of the host. And so when I break the host or we're done serving, I look at the bottom of the gold vessel, which is the chalice or the ciborium, and I see particles, okay? And so we take great care to be sure all the particles are there. We pour the water, and then we consume them, okay? So we don't just put it back on the shelf because that's him, okay, until it's all gone. And so we have great reverence for all of that. And then we put the remaining hosts into the tabernacle. We close the door, lock it so it's reserved and secure, and we genuflect before it. He's the king. We can't see him because he's in the tabernacle, but we just use great honor and great rigor in regard to reverencing the fact that the King of Kings is with us as he wants to be, as we want him to be. Okay. So let's take our time now to look as the flow in Mass. And so we have about 15 minutes left. So if you have your missalettes, if you don't have one, we have some on the back table. And there are these books here. Good, y'all have them. Good deal, okay. If not, please grab them. Good deal, okay. And if you would, let's go ahead and open up, please, to page number 85 in your book, page number 85. There's a lot on that page. We'll go over it now. This is a great introduction, okay? So I'd like to begin by saying that, you know, foundational to a relationship, a friendship, or courtship, foundational is thanksgiving. You know, I think that gratitude oftentimes is the foundation of a relationship. You know, I'm so grateful to know you. I'm so happy you're my friend. You've been so good to me. And just gratitude. And so I think that's foundational for a good relationship. And it's certainly foundational to this, our relationship with him. You know, we start to recognize or realize we thank you for everything. I'm so grateful for life and health and freedom and the promise of heaven. It's like, wow, my heart just is full of gratitude for you. And that is the beginning of a relationship. I want to go deeper. I want more, okay? And so I'd like to just, and because of time, you know, the Psalms, many of the Psalms begin with the That's where the psalmist is thanking God. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his love is everlasting. You know, Psalm 107, Psalm 118, Psalm 138. Many of the psalms begin that way. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. And so we do that in a unified way in the Mass. Every Mass, we're giving thanks to God for his goodness to us. So in the little definition there, it says Christians are baptized into the Paschal mystery of Christ. And we talked about the Paschal mystery, the suffering, the death, the resurrection, the ascension, and the sending. We're baptized into the Paschal mystery of Christ. There it is, death and resurrection. For what? For the forgiveness of sin and the fullness of salvation. See, when we're baptized, we're born again, and original sin is washed away, and we are have the indwelling of God's Holy Spirit. This mystery is celebrated in every Mass, remembering Christ's loving deed, there he is on the cross, and giving thanks and praise to God. By this action, the sacrifice of the cross is continuously made present in the church. Folks, just we're going to review this again next week, but if you have the globe and you have Christians here and here and here and here on all the 24 time zones, and as the world turns, okay, in every time zone, if there are people celebrating what God wants us to celebrate, that means that our thanksgiving to him never ends. And there's some psalms that say, from the rising of the sun to the setting, my name is great, and everywhere the pure, spotless sacrifice is offered to my name. And so it's like, oh. And so what is being said here, by this action, the sacrifice of the cross is continuously made present to God in his church as we celebrate him over and over again. Like I say, we pray every day in our little church, and can you imagine all the way up to Chicago, Indiana, Canada, all these down to South America, all the Catholic churches that are in that time zone are celebrating at that hour, and then the next hour, and then the next hour. And so it really, really never ends, our worship of God. Okay, which is the way he wants it. Okay. First Corinthians refers to, Paul says, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes again. Okay. So in your book there, it refers to the gifts. Okay. If you're coming from another church, you probably had a little collection in your church to keep the church going. We do too. So it becomes right in the middle of the celebration. And we call it the collection. Right now, because of COVID, we don't pass the basket to keep people from touching it. We just have people put the money in it before or after Mass in the set-aside areas where they can put their gift in there. Okay. And then we bring forward gifts. We bring forward bread and wine, and they're brought to the altar. It's not just any bread now. We use the very same bread as the Last Supper, unleavened bread, not leavened bread, and it's wine. It's not grape juice. I know there are some denominations that say they don't drink. They don't drink alcohol, or it's not good to drink wine. And I remember this one woman was saying that, I don't drink wine. I don't think anybody should drink wine. I said, well, you know, we do, because we don't use grape juice in the liturgy. We use wine. And by the way, I said, you know, that was Jesus' first miracle. He changed at the wedding feast of Cana. They were celebrating, and he changed water into wine. And his last miracle was wine into blood. He said, take and drink, this is my blood. So our Lord drank wine. And she says, you know, I know that. I would have liked him a lot better if he hadn't have done that. He did do that. And so there's nothing wrong in good stead to have a sip of wine. Okay. All right, so let's look at the verbiage here so that when it's being said at Mass, blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread that we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. So that's awaiting the miracle where it will become, Jesus is the bread of life. And so we use those words. In just a moment, it will become, by the power of the Holy Spirit and the hands of the priest, the bread of life. And then the people say, blessed be God forever. Okay? And then the next is, I hold up the chalice filled with wine. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creations, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. So at that moment, it's still bread and wine, okay? And then we say, pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice, see, we keep referring to the sacrifice, worship involves sacrifice, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. And then you use the word sacrifice, and you respond, may the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Okay. Then there's a prayer that I pray, and it's different for every Mass. On the next page there, you can take a peek in your book. And all those are prayers. That's for every week in the particular book you have all through December, Advent, and Christmas, and into January and February. So let's turn over, if you would, to page number, I believe, 90. Let's take a look at page number 90. It says the Eucharistic prayer at the top, okay? This is a little interchange that the church gives between me, the priest, and you, and I say, the Lord be with you, and you would say, and with your spirit, lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord, and here it is. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Again, thanksgiving, Eucharist. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and just. And then there's four basic Eucharistic prayers that we pray, okay? And so, first of all, we're talking about the preface, so we'll look at the first preface here. Most of the prayers, like when we had the Creed, they're directed to God as Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And you'll see that very thing in these prayers here. So, for example, in the middle of the page there, it says, it is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Father, most holy. Okay, so there's the reference to the Father. Through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, that's the second person of the Trinity, your Word, through whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Savior and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit. There's the third person. And so these beautiful prayers that the church has given to us, you know, there's a great direction to them. We're praising God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, okay? The Eucharistic prayer is a prayer that is indeed directed to the Father, and at the very end, we bring in the Son and the Holy Spirit, okay, as far as our direction. So it's directed to the Father in honor of the Son. Let's take a look where it says on your book there, it says, holy, 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 okay? And so, Brandon, if you could, if it's easy to go back to that comparative language, if you would, if you're able to find that, I think that'll help us on that. So what we do is we pray this beautiful prayer. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Okay. We're getting close. Yeah, there it is. Comparatives and superlatives. In English, if we want to talk about a word and a descriptor, and then we want to say that this is a little bit better, that's the next level of good, and then the very best level of good is best. And so in English, we would use different words. We would say good, better, best. But in the Hebrew language, to stay with that, they didn't have comparative and superlative words in their language. And so if they wanted to up the level of goodness, they would say good, good. So they would say, oh, that's good, good. If they wanted to up it even to the highest, they would say it three times. They would say, oh, good, 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 which means that's best. That's the greatest that it could be. So when there is repetition in the Hebrew language, that meant it's a higher level of being, okay? And so when we say holy, 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 that means it's the highest level of holiness that we're attributing to God, okay? And that's what the angels sing, okay? Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts. And so when we pray that in church, that gives you an idea of what we're doing. He is the holiest of all. He is the greatest. He's the holiest of all, okay? Okay, then the Eucharistic prayer. The first Eucharistic prayer there, and that's on your page number, let's see. Right after, we'll go on page 92. Okay, we're moving good. Page 92, Eucharistic prayer 1. And if you want to highlight in your book, whatever, I like just to point out some things to you, okay? In the very first line, Eucharistic prayer 1. We pray this rarely. We pray to Christmas and Easter. It's lengthy, but it's very profound. That's why I want to use it to begin to explain what we're talking about. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, who are we directing this prayer to? The Father. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, underline Father, okay? We make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, the bread and wine that we brought forward, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your church. Be pleased to grant her peace, guard, night, govern throughout the world, together with the Pope and the Bishop and all of that, okay? We come on down more on the page there, and we're going to go to... After it says, remember, Lord, your servants, and we can put in some special people there to remember. You know, we want to remember, depending on who the Mass is being prayed for, and all gathered here whose faith is known to you alone. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offered for themselves. There's the word sacrifice again, okay? In the next column, in communion with those whose memory we venerate, in communion with those whose memory we venerate, and especially we remember the Mother of the Lord. So we say, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary. She's a creature, not a creator. She's a very special creature to be the Mother of Jesus, okay? And then we bring in others that we want to remember, okay? Mother of our God and Lord Jesus, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse. And then we name some of the apostles and martyrs. Peter and Paul, they both died martyrs. Andrew, and then several more. So those are the apostles: Peter, Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude. So when we call them by name, we're just going right back to the Last Supper. These are, when we say apostolic succession, we remember the first Mass was the Last Supper. Then the next names there are the first popes. Right after Peter was Linus, and then Cletus, and then Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian. So we just give honor to the first leaders that went out and did what Jesus asked them to do, to pray the Mass and to baptize, okay? And then we have early martyrs, and that's Lawrence and Chrysogonus, John and Paul, and Cosmas and Damian, just a few. There's so many martyrs, and all your saints. So those names that you hear, that the church is just lifting them up, they were the first apostles, the first popes, and the first martyrs. Okay, and then we look at page number 93 and the second paragraph there. And so, at that time, I'm going to take my hands, okay, on the altar, and here's the bread and here's the wine. I take my hands and I do this. And so what I'm doing is I'm calling down God's Holy Spirit in a manifestation there, that I'm calling down Him, the Holy Spirit, the third person, to transubstantiate these elements and to get ready to change them into the body and blood of Jesus. Okay, so we call down there. And so when I say this prayer on your page, on 93, be pleased, O Lord, we pray, to bless, acknowledge and approve this offering in every respect, make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. The Greek word is epiklesis, and what that is means that's the calling down of the Holy Spirit on the elements to be changed into the body and blood of Jesus. And that will happen when I say the words, this is my body, and that's the consecration, okay? So we've called down the Holy Spirit, okay? And then it continues. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with his eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing. This is what Jesus did on Holy Thursday, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body. That's when it changes, which will be given up for you. And then I hold up the element, the host, and you can adore. You say, wow, my Lord and my God, there he is, okay? That's what our Lord did at the Last Supper. He said, take and eat, okay? So we do that, okay? It is not a symbol, and we don't call it a symbol. Jesus didn't say, this is a symbol of my body. Jesus said, this is my body. And so that's what I say. I stand in the place of Christ, and I say his words. I have no business doing that, but that's the way he wants to do it. So I don't say this is Jesus' body. I say this is my body. I say the very words that he said at the Last Supper, okay? And then the same thing on your page there where we talk with the 93, when I take up the chalice. Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood. Then it changes. the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Okay? Yes. The question is there a significance to the bells ringing at that time? And there is. It's something that is not necessary today, but we've kind of kept it through the years. Picture a long time ago that the Mass was in Latin, and the reason the Mass was in Latin, that was the original language in Rome and all that. And then for the universality, you'd think one faith, one language. And so wherever it was celebrated, as it got further and further away, they celebrated the Mass in Latin. And the way they did it is the significance would be that here's the tabernacle, here's the cross, and I'm leading the people to go to Christ, and so my back is to you. We didn't have microphones, okay? So we're praying the Mass, and I lift up the elements like this, and so if you're lucky, depending on a big church, you can probably see the host that's lift up that's now become the body and blood of Jesus. And it was customary in those days, first of all, you couldn't hear, okay? And then many people were deep in other prayer. I know my mom would be praying other prayers, but when you hear the bells, you look up, and that's the moment of consecration, okay? So it was just an attention getter. It was to allow people to know that this is the moment where he's truly here sacramentally. I adore, okay? And then when they do the chalice, and he's there, okay? But now I'm facing the people, and you can see me, and it's in the vernacular language, so it's in English in America, it's in Spanish in Spain, and in Italy it's in Italian. But here again, it's just a ceremonial thing that we do, and it adds to it. Here he is, here he is. So we do ring the bells. Not every church does, but we do. Okay, very good. Okay, let's turn the page, please, in your books there. So now it's done. Now he's on the altar. Now it's no longer bread and wine, it's our Lord. And so what do? We say, therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the blessed passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son. See, Lord is referring to God the Father. And it can be confusing. You know, when we say Lord, what do we think of when we say Lord? We think of Lord Jesus, don't we? But in the Old Testament, 450 times was the word Adonai. And the word Adonai means God, means Lord, my Lord. El Shaddai, God Almighty, Elohim, God, Yahweh, God. And so in this part of the Eucharistic prayer, when we say Lord, we're referring to the Father, we're referring to. And that's why it says, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we pray, we your servants and your holy people, offer your glorious majesty, the pure victim, Jesus, the holy victim, Jesus, the spotless victim, Jesus, okay? The holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance and accept them, as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servants, Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham. Remember? He was going to kill his son Isaac because God asked him to do it, and then God stopped him. He says, I know how much you love me and how much you were going to obey me. So he didn't have to sacrifice his son. And the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, okay? Folks, there's so many linkages. We'll get into that. Genesis 14 was Melchizedek, and he was a priest and a king, and he offered the unbloody sacrifice to God, and it prefigured this. There's not a bloody sacrifice here. It's not a lamb or a goat that we're offering to God. We're offering the bloodless sacrifice like Melchizedek, okay? Okay. And we pray that your holy angel will take this to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Okay. And after that prayer, we have even some more saints that we commemorate. As we move along through Eucharistic Prayer 1, this is page 94 of the right column, you know, and we remember fellowship with your holy apostles, John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas. Those are all saints, Ignatius, Peter, Felicity, Agatha, Lucy, Cecilia, and all your saints, okay? So we're closing out the Eucharistic Prayer. So if you would, then let's turn. There's three Eucharistic prayers, four that we use. Eucharistic Prayer 2 is very short. We use it on weekdays most of the time. Eucharistic 3, Prayer 3 we use mostly on Sundays. and 4 has got its own special opportunities. Let's go to page number. We only do one. There's 4 choices that we have. Page number 102, please. 102. And we're almost there. But forgive me, but go back one page, 101. And this is the end of any of the Eucharistic prayers. I hold up now the elements that have become Jesus. I hold up the paten, which has the host in it, and the deacon would hold up the chalice that has the blood of Jesus in it. And we say that beautiful prayer I just said, through him, Jesus, with him, Jesus, in him, Jesus, O God, Almighty Father, there it is in your book on page 101. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever, to which you, the people, say amen. Okay. And then right into the Lord's Prayer. And so we have the Our Father. And that's on your page 102. There's 2 versions of the Our Father, Luke and Matthew. We use Matthew. And notice that we say Our Father. We're the family. He's the Father, one family. And it's a beautiful prayer. And that little interlude there, deliver us, O Lord, we pray, from every evil, is a beautiful interlude we put in there before we say, for the kingdom, for thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, now and forever. Amen. You know, if you look at both Luke and Matthew, the little interlude that you as a Protestant may have said, for thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, that's not in Scripture. It's a beautiful ending. And so we wrap it in there after we put the interlude in there about delivering us from every evil. And then we come back and we say that. But it's a beautiful ending. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. And then in good times, we would go right into the sign of peace. It was so great to shake hands or give a hug or an embrace and things like that. But we don't suggest it anymore. But we say a gesture of peace or just an expression. If you're close enough, you could say, peace be with you, like that, to your family or whatever. But it's a great moment to share a sign or an indication of peace at that moment. Jesus is the Prince of Peace, and now he's there with us, okay? Then we enter into the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Those are the very words of John. In the Gospel of John, John the Baptist sees Jesus, and he says, there is the Lamb of God. And he says it twice in the early part of the Gospel of John. And so we use the words, behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Okay. And then, after that prayer, Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Those are the very words of Scripture. You know, the centurion said that to Jesus when he went to get his slave, or his, there's 2 versions, his slave or his son, healed. And Jesus says, go, he's healed. And it was a miracle that he worked from afar. But in Matthew 8 is one version, and that's where those words come from. There's so much that we say in the Mass that comes right from the Bible. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but just say the word, and my soul or my son or my slave would be healed. And so that comes from Scripture, okay? And then we have a communion hymn or a communion invocation, and then we have Holy Communion. And so when the people come forward for Holy Communion, we have them come forward and they would have a reverential bow if they're the next in line. Like if I'm waiting, I would have a reverential bow knowing that that's the king, and then step forward and the priest or the extraordinary minister would say the body of Christ, and the proper response would be amen. So the person receiving would say amen. What does amen mean? At that moment, it means I believe that that's Jesus, I accept that's Jesus, and I adore that is Jesus. So that's this. It's very simple. You don't have to say a lot. There's other traditions where you say more words, but we would just say amen, the body of Christ or the blood of Christ, and the person would say amen. And then we would allow them to either take a sip or to take the host on their tongue or in their hand and feed themselves. So it's a holy moment. And he was there supernaturally and substantially until it's no longer wine or until it's no longer bread. And so you don't want to chew the host. The sister says they don't chew the host when we were learning. But here again, you know, I'd like to think you would want it to last as long as you could. And then just thank them and love them and let them love you when you receive our Lord in Holy Communion. That's the closest we're going to get to God this side of heaven, is to have that one flesh union, that's the flesh of Jesus, comes into us in Holy Communion. It's a wonderful thing. Then at the very end, folks, after you've had the chance to have some powerful time with our Lord in meditation, then we stand up for the final prayer, and then we have the final blessing. So in your book, I think that would be on page number, there's some prayers there, and then it ends on page number 111. So 111. And the Lord be with you, okay? And then may Almighty God bless you, halfway down 111. And I give you the blessing. I'm blessing you now. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Again, you say amen. And then I would say, or the deacon would say, go. The Mass is ended. Go in peace. And there's the dispatch. That's where we get the word Mass. Go. The Mass is ended. Go in peace. To which you would say, thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. And then we would have a recessional hymn and go forward from there. And so what we just did this afternoon or this evening, folks, is to talk about the Liturgy of the Eucharist and the concluding rites, which is the second half of what you would experience if you go to Mass anywhere in the world, anywhere. I like to say it's the same but different, same but different. There's going to be a different personality in the priest, okay? There's going to be different readings every day, and there's going to be a different homily. Depends on the reflection that that priest has with regard to sharing with you. But it's the same format, okay? It's the same format, so it's the same but different. And you're going to love that as you go around and you travel. The people that go down to Orange Beach, they say, gosh, it was the same but different. And it's a holy thing all around the world. So it's the very same form. I want to thank you. We went just a little over. I want to thank you. Any questions, I'm here. So if you want to stay late and just ask your questions, it's good. And I want to wish you well. So please come back next week. Please come this weekend and celebrate with us. And don't receive communion, but receive a blessing. Come forward like this, and we'd love to have you. And thanks so much. So let's whisper a little glory. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. And the Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you. Go in peace. God bless.